Dear colleagues, welcome to our webinar. This is the webinar for local governments and municipal authorities constituency to the UNFCC, hosted by ICLE, Local Governments for Sustainability and its capacity as the focal point. We'll just give a couple of minutes to our colleagues to settle down for their settings so that we don't disturb. It will be maximum 1 or 2 minutes. So thanks for your patience and we'll connect soon. So I guess we will be gradually starting. I can make some introductory remarks and then proceed with the agenda today. And so welcome once again. My name is Ünsal Kan. I'm Director of Global Advocacy at ICLE, World Secretariat based in Bonn, Germany. And I'm also the focal point of the LGMA constituency to the UNFCC. For those colleagues who have not been involved in our webinars before, we are recording these sessions and then sharing it on our YouTube channels. The logic or common practice is that we go through a basic presentation, and depending on the agenda, we have some colleagues joining us. We always have, like, our default guest is our Cities Biodiversity Center. Colleagues are sharing the updates from the biodiversity agenda at the end of our climate-specific agendas, and I'm very happy that Laura will deliver it today in the afternoon. These webinars are held twice in every month in that same day so that we can enable Eastern and Western Hemisphere colleagues to attend in decent times. We usually try to finish around those presentations around the first 40 minutes, and then the remaining 15 minutes or so, we open the space for question and answer. During the presentation, feel free to, you can type in your points or questions to the chat box or Q&A box. But, and if there's extremely burning issue, we can already give a break and respond to you. But if not, we usually prefer to have them all discussed after we go through the whole presentation. So with this, without further delays, I'd like to kick off our discussions. For our agenda today, we will be having a basic introduction for those who are familiar, who are not familiar with the LGMA constituency, but for some of you, this may be repetitive. So we beg your indulgence, and as well as we will go through the updates since the last webinar. These are month webinars, and after our webinars, we usually have a couple of points that have been taking place, and we basically review this. We will focus on the stock take. A couple of slides are reserved for that, and especially on that one, I also would like to invite my colleague Kale to join us, because he has been leading our work on that. And we'll spend some time on the LGMA submissions, and especially the upcoming key agendas in Nairobi, in Bonn, and Dubai. And this will be the moment where we'll also listen from our colleague Laura about the biodiversity process. So if we continue on our discussions, unfortunately, since the beginning of the year, every month we had faced another disaster, another really heartbreaking stories, either as an earthquake that has happened in Turkey and Syria, or the hurricane or cyclone Freddy hitting Mozambique and Malawi. And in these webinars, we have expressed our endorsement or support to our leaders who are trying to support their citizens or lead the relief efforts. Obviously, both of those disasters, both the earthquake and the cyclones, yes, it is more than weeks and more than months now almost have passed. But we are hearing from our mayors that their situations are still dire, especially in Mozambique and Malawi. There are still risks of public health. And also in the case of Turkey, the mayor of Izmir and all the other mayors around the cities are still struggling to establish temporary or permanent resettlement spaces. So for those who are able to, we are still encouraging you to support financially or politically and technically our mayors and our leaders there so that they can support their citizens, as mentioned by Mayor Arabo from Kelimane as well. For the LGMA, this is the body or this is the community that is the voice of cities and regions in the UN climate negotiations since 1995. We have multiple tracks throughout the year to engage ourselves into the negotiations. We particularly try to influence the negotiations by our inputs. This can happen through our submissions or participation in relevant meetings, in person or virtual. We are participating in developing and implementation of the action agenda, initiatives, partnerships, cross-sectoral, cross-stakeholder initiatives by the champions. We, of course, do our best to support the COP presidencies who are having their own priorities, and we do our best that these are connected to each other from one presidency to the other. And we're very happy so far. There has been a very smooth collaboration, and we are grateful for this spirit. And of course, the outcome of the UNFCCC has to be a consensus among all parties, and among them, we have a broad group of parties from the global north and south who support the agenda of multi-level action. And we are working with them so that they can help us to table proposals or influence into the negotiation documents, because we as an observer cannot submit documents as such. This is only has to be supported by parties or submitted by the parties. And that's what we would work, and especially national or regional initiatives of the UNFCCC parties, UNFCCC Friends of Multi-Level Action, we also do our best to engage with them as appropriate to demonstrate this collective spirit of collaboration. Throughout the year, we have been introducing a number of opportunities to share our experience. Obviously, these are monthly webinars, as you see in the calendar. Since the beginning of this year, we started to develop our monthly bulletin. This is mainly a digest that is capturing our communication on the emails or what we have presented here in the webinars. And the good news that this is available online and you can share it widely. And we are also more than happy to integrate in input from the LGMA community. We are very happy. There are more and more inputs are coming from our partners. And the next one will be released tomorrow, just before the Earth Day. That will be the biggest agenda of this month. We have been over the weeks at the beginning of the year, since the beginning of the year, we have focused our priorities, and we have mapped several agendas. And obviously, this is a complex process. Therefore, we try to capture them in three main work streams. One, the events or processes led by UN and UNFCCC. In that regard, we are not the key drivers. Of course, we are participating or supporting those according to the UN procedures. Then different national and global processes, especially like G7, G20, are having their own agendas or individual national governments. And we are also trying to help them or engage with them. And finally, we as LGMA members, we have our own initiatives, our own processes, and we also like to make those initiatives or outcomes influence or relevant as appropriate to global agendas, and then so that we can make the impact that we wish to see in terms of expanding the multi-level action and sustainable urbanization across the whole sustainability agendas. let's remember we had three key takeaways from Sharm el-Sheikh. First of all, we are happy. Now, the second phase of the Paris Agreement is now fully in place, which is the ambition agenda was designed in Glasgow and at COP26. And Sharm el-Sheikh was particularly very important with the climate justice coming to the space. So now the challenge is how to respond all these new realities or new commitments with the key defining factors or rate determining steps as the availability of finance, the effectiveness of governance models, and the opportunities through capacity building so that our leaders, our experts can really put all these commitments into action. The thing that is now very essential now, it's very clear in the second phase of the Paris Agreement, be it the UNFCCC agenda, we will go through it again, or be it national efforts, the new normal is to have multi-level action as embedded into the whole Paris Agreement. The Paris and Glasgow text has enabled us, and we are very happy to see this, that sustainable urbanization and multi-level action, these are defining two slightly different scopes. Multi-level action is much more a political process, whereas urbanization is a much more sectoral development track. And the roles and responsibilities in each of them are slightly different. But we want to act in both areas so that we could make sure that the Paris Agreement second phase is much better and faster implemented than the first one. The funding that is inevitable is that this second phase of the Paris Agreement, especially with the UNFCCC engagement, should be much more robust and reflect to the spirit, especially this multi-stakeholder spirit. But it's also clear that the traditional COP, these 2 weeks, especially thousands of people, it's also not manageable as such. We are expecting there will be some new changes on the way to come, and we would like to influence this as well, especially with the stocktake process. We would like to make sure a new wave of multi-level action is coming up bottom-up so that implementation of COP is also taking place at the city halls, and that's exactly the spirit of stocktake, which we will discuss later on. This year, three priorities for us: operationalization of our surge initiative, because it was exactly the spirit of bridging multi-level spirit and the sustainable urbanization into the climate agenda. We are very happy it is positively taken by both the Sharm el-Sheikh community, but also the COP28 president is also eager to work on that. And we are seeing so many national initiatives coming up, and we want to make sure that this is now rolled out across the world. And we are hoping to have more updates, especially with the UN Habitat also in the process, the leading UN agency. Stocktake, we will talk about it. This is a unique opportunity to introduce a new momentum, both at the local level, but also influence the discussions in Dubai at the end of the year, and even shape the next phase, because the global stocktake will take a couple of years ahead. Therefore, action on the ground this year before Dubai will be even important, if equally important, to shape the success of Dubai outcomes. And finally, we are seeing, as we discussed, so many UNFCCC agendas are inviting our engagement. We have to be prepared, and we are very happy that we have already started to engage very actively with the BEAT ministerial meetings or workshops. LGMA members are actively taking place, participating in these agendas to the extent possible, because that depends on logistical challenges, sometimes financial, but also available staff and time resources as well. We are following the presidencies. The Egyptian presidency is responsible to convene the official meetings and keep the momentum. But we are also aware the incoming presidency, the Emirates government, is also very actively involved in the process. They are starting to develop their own campaigns, initiatives. One example was the announcement we had in March between Bloomberg and the president-designate. There are some more updates on that. We are expecting in the Petersburg dialogue in the beginning of May, there will be more announcements coming up. And we are also confident that the vision will definitely have a stronger emphasis to multi-level action, hopefully, by the time we reach those strategic guidance from the presidency. What has happened since March webinar we had? Obviously, this couple of weeks was relatively one of the coolest period of the year, which is not very often, coolest in the sense that the two big communities of the world, where the Islamic community was going through the Ramadan period, the month of Ramadan, the Holy Month Ramadan, and the Christian world has also gone through around 10 days or so of the Easter holiday. So many of those events, many of the partners have did their best to avoid any big event in this period. There are a couple of moments that was really peaking our efforts, and we were very happy that we were part of those. If we look at the UN agenda, important updates came up from search, especially from the UN Habitat space. We are very happy that UN Habitat released the report of the COP27 ministerial meeting on urbanization and climate change. That is very, very encouraging, because it will be an opportunity to influence the upcoming UN Habitat Assembly and the June sessions. And we are very happy to see the very, very respectful recognition of the acknowledgement of the LGMA constituency, both in the design of this event, but also with their extracts from their messages and a well-received welcoming message from the parties and the UN agencies. We have also noticed that the surge and urbanization ministry was also very promisingly presented at the UN Habitat 2022 report. And in recognition of all these strong relations with UN Habitat or the urban ministerial community, ICLEI, in its capacity as an observer to the UN Habitat and LGMA focal point, requested to deliver a statement at the UN Habitat Executive Board meeting in 28th of March. The board of UN Habitat is the political institution. It's around 80 members, member countries, who give guidance to UN Habitat Secretariat and the team, and they take care of the implementation of the decisions between the UN Habitat assemblies. The importance of the executive board is that on the way to Sharm el-Sheikh, the UN Habitat Executive Board in March meeting had made an important decision that they mandated the UN Habitat Executive Director to convene, in collaboration with COP27 presidency, an event on urban housing and urbanization issues, which was the source of our influence into the process. And although we had been asking for this for years, literally, and we have already mentioned in our first intervention to the first meeting of UN Habitat Executive Board, the real action, to kick off the action, came from this board decision of UN Habitat. So in that regard, in our statement, which was live, communicated live, I intervened virtually, but the Committee of the Permanent Representatives, they were having their meetings in Nairobi. We express our gratitude for the Executive Board of UN Habitat, and we encourage them to build upon those in the upcoming UN Habitat decisions in the UN Habitat Assembly. We hope this will have influence into the preparations. And the global level, there are two things that is really very, very encouraging, and we have been preparing for that for a long time. The first one just came a couple of days ago. You may have received from our announcements that there is really a breakthrough in the G7 Environment, Climate and Energy Ministerial that was held in Sapporo last week. And these ministers have decided to launch a special roundtable on subnational climate action, and in collaboration with Urban 7 leadership. The voice of local governments in the G7 process will be a key partner of this process. In fact, this is really very welcoming, because last year during German presidency, we had already achieved major recognition, and the Sustainable Urbanization Ministerial was also very, very effective. We had a communique from Leaders Summit and many ministerials, including environment ministers. But this Sapporo meeting had taken all these commitments to one step ahead, and having a spatial roundtable is a very, very significant step forward. And we will go through this in the next slide. Next week, although it's after today's webinar, but I still want to address this because it's a very important opportunity. The Cities Summit of Americas will be convened in Denver, under the leadership of the State Department and with a broad stakeholder engagement and across Americas. We will also have a slide for that, and I will also ask my colleague Kale to give some insight on that. On the LGMA side, we have advanced on stock take for emergency, and nominations and submissions are on the way. We also have our dedicated slides This one is particularly focusing again on the Sapporo outcomes. Just a couple of minutes ago, the Urban 7 also released their welcoming and commending the G7 ministers of environment for this bold action and for this inclusive action. If you look at the paragraphs, you would notice that it is really a process that it will hopefully have consequences both in the G20 and at the COP28 process, because the Japanese presidency is committed to report the outcomes to these platforms. And we are very happy that the terms of reference also makes a reference to the Stocktake process. That's also very, very encouraging. We are expecting this roundtable to happen in the mid or let's say around September by Japan. Whether it will be in person or virtual, we have to listen to their updates. And one additional important text, it says that the ministers of environment are committed to continue their work with urban ministers. That is very, very key, because you remember we were very happy in Sharm el Sheikh because for the first time, urban ministers were engaged actively in the COP agenda because of this decision from UNEP and Executive Board. However, during the meeting, we have observed, because of the negotiation agendas, the participation of climate ministers and urban environment ministers was not that much diverse or strong as the urban ministers, which is for a first time event, it may be okay. And we still believe it was a good start. But this G7 recognition that for their climate action, they would continue to work with ministers of urbanization under the G7, which will continue this year, also in July, but also outside G7, is an extremely valuable commitment. And we are seeing the value of this cross-sectoral collaboration and the LGMA community, Urban 7 and Urban 20 community, being the bridge between those climate and urban communities is really something that we are very proud of. During the Sapporo meeting, the Urban 7 community was present because we were invited to display our posters. We have shared our 2023 Urban 7 Mayor's Declaration, as we have already submitted to the Japanese government officials. But through these posters, we were also able to communicate this to the G7 Environment Ministers community as well. And the Cities Summit of America, you can see the homepage of this event. The full agenda is already released. It is really a very diverse set of activities, plenaries and breakout groups. A number of announcements is on the way. It is encompassing all cities from Canada to Chile across the Americas. And it's also a unique collaboration between the different governments of the Americas. In fact, what we are seeing this as a unique leadership of the US government, the Biden administration, especially in the last couple of years. Let's remember, over these years, they have demonstrated a very interesting, very ambitious commitments and actions, which is taking really the bar of multi-level action higher and higher. Let's remember, the second US NDC was much more ambitious than the previous one because they engaged with cities and states and tribes. Immediately after the NDC, the US federal government adopted the Inflation Reduction Act, which was localizing the federal budget to the local and state governments in the US, which was exactly our vision of localization of finance. US government once again took a leadership by assigning or appointing the first ever subnational diplomacy special representative. Deputy Mayor from Los Angeles, Nina Hachigan, is now a diplomat, US diplomat. And of course, her influence is huge in the driving of this summit and of the rest. At COP27, the US government was also very active because they have announced a new initiative scale, and they were very actively involved in the urbanization ministerial. And of course, over these years, the US government is also working with Japan to convene the Zero Carbon City Forum since 2020. So this is, in a nutshell, whether the Cities Summit of Americas we can think about. I'm very happy my colleague Kale is also actively engaged in the design in collaboration with the networks in the US and the Americas. If you want, Kale, you can also give a couple of more insights or what we should expect from this summit that will be remarkable, I hope. So we are eager to hear you now.
Great. Thank you, Yunus. Hello, everyone. It is always nice when the United States is associated with leadership around climate. Yunus, you've done a great job of outlining how that is showing up with the recent position of Ambassador Nina Hachigian. In her role, the Department of Energy installing a sustainable communities office, and then a whole slate of federal funding that is directed toward local government in a really direct way. So not sending money through state or regional governments. That's still happening, of course, under the IRA and the infrastructure bill. But this kind of new moment that we're in of understanding that cities have spent decades planning for climate change, have really robust implementation strategies around rolling out concrete climate initiatives. So it's time to literally pass the buck to mayors, to councils, to cities, to work on climate action in that really direct multi-level type of way. So this is at the core of the city summit, which is the first city summit of the Americas. As Yunus had said, serving the entire Western Hemisphere. Many of you or some of you on the line may be there in Denver next week. And I really look forward to connecting with you. This summit is growing out of the 9th Summit of the Americas, which was focused at the national level for all countries in the Western Hemisphere. But again, the first city summit, but does mirror the same priorities of that 9th summit that happened last year in Los Angeles. So climate at the core, addressing the climate emergency is one of these pillars. But also social inclusion, economic recovery, safeguarding democracy and democratic systems, and then ushering in this equitable digital transformation. All to say that recognition that the work that we do in the LGMA is reaching beyond only the climate sphere, is bringing climate and urban communities together. That also is showing up really strongly here next week in Denver. So some great announcements coming out all throughout the week, and we will be sharing those with you. But watch out for those. Thanks, Yunus.
Thanks, Kyle, and congratulations for all the networks in the Americas positively responding to this really warm invitation from the U.S. State Department. And we have seen so many agendas are led by different networks, so we also would like to commend all our partners there. And we look forward to your announcements so that we can take it forward to the rest of the UN agendas. Let's continue in our presentation, which is stocktake. A very, very important agenda that we are speaking since the last year's second half or at the beginning of the year. The stocktake is becoming more, let's say, concrete and real as we get closer to Dubai. This is a process officially is, in fact, not anymore a voluntary contribution of local governments, but we have a legal background, which is the 2015 Paris Agreement recognizes all levels of government. The 2021 Glasgow Climate Pact recognizes the need for multi-level collaboration. And last year in June, the UNFCCC negotiators also agreed that this process should receive inputs at the local and national level. These are all, for us, justifications why we should convene such stocktake discussions on Paris Agreement at the local level. Again, it's not the first time we are pushing this. We had the experience that a wonderful experience of Talanoa dialogues in 2018. It was more than 40 countries and 60 sessions, and there were so many mobilizations. In fact, many of those sessions have played an important role to bring new NDCs in Glasgow climate COP26. But of course, in the Talanoa dialogue, we didn't have any races. We didn't have any commitments. We didn't have any meaningful NDCs. So this time, it's even much more essential for us to have this conversation. And in that regard, we are once again aiming to reach out to our members to once again use this opportunity to, first of all, kick off a new momentum at the local level, that our communities have an opportunity and a rationale to discuss climate action again in their constitutions, in their domestic agendas. We have seen wave of climate emergency marches, Fridays for Futures, and we are seeing, because of the wars and a number of economic crises as well, the climate agenda is slightly being taken back. But these meetings can also give us the chance that you can bring back the climate agenda forefront of your agenda. And of course, this is the time to focus on what is the reason to, or what will be the things you will discuss. These are the topics we would like to suggest that you focus on your local commitments, whether you are implementing effectively or whether you need to strengthen them. You have to focus on, or we have to discuss our national commitments, whether it's reaching to the local level or vice versa. And we have to address climate justice, whether all communities are able to benefit from this participation opportunities and access to this new opportunities through low carbon development. And in fact, we really would like to take one, would expect our councils and administration to take ownership. In practical terms, we really recommend all of our members to convene these meetings in their city halls, town halls, or parliaments, so that they can turn the COP, turn their city halls into a mini COP. This will also be giving us the opportunity that we can introduce a new wave of global multilateralism, so that we do not wait for the COPs, but we inform COPs through our discussions here and then let them take on board what we have been discussing. In that regard, the audience of these meetings should be local business, local researchers, scientists, gender, women, youth group, parliamentarians. So all those who are part and responsible of the climate action in their communities. In that regard, we will follow the Talanoa spirit, that it will be an inclusive dialogue, especially on the three perspectives: where are we, where do we want to go, and how do we get there? And especially because we have so many commitments and so many now documents, we believe these meetings will already start with a good baseline, that there will be an opportunity to discuss the commitments, but especially how to scale up, how to go faster will be the biggest discussion. And we have already been mapping this. So starting from Earth Day on 22nd of April, there will be a kickoff with the spirit of this momentum coming up. We already had a discussion with Earth Day Network, and they are promoting as well. We believe during the June conference of the UNFCCC, there will be big discussions, and that will also give us the opportunity to reinforce our commitment. And very likely, majority of those stocktake meetings will happen after June. But before June, we're already excited that now, after all these weeks and months of dialogues, we are seeing our cities and regions stepping up their commitments. And the first example, we are very proud, Concord from state of New Hampshire has now announced that they officially will host their stocktake for climate emergency of Concord City on the 22nd of May at the Concord City Hall. For those who would like to express their engagement, we have our own enrollment form. We will also make this available once again. The toolkit will be available for those who have committed to take action. We only ask two main commitments for those who to be recognized in this global mobilization. The first thing is that those cities and regions who will convene the stocktakes, they confirm that they will focus on these three topics: the local commitments, the national climate agenda, and climate justice. And then report us the results so that we can convey this to the UNFCCC, to Dubai, in our capacity as LGMA focal point. So that is the main expectation. And as we said, starting from tomorrow onwards, we are congratulating the city of Concord as the first city to step up. But we are aware there are already others on the road to come up. So maybe a couple of complimentary points from Kale, who has been working intensively to develop the toolkit and mobilization across the world. Any points, Kale, you'd like to add on?
Yeah, you did a great job covering, Eunice. I guess I would just say that we are officially in kickoff mode, and we'll have announcements about additional U.S. communities hosting their events. We have everything that you need, and Eunice and me and others around the LGMA are here to support your own event in your country, in your community, and that we'll be, synthesizing all the outcomes from these different events into a nice, summary to share with our UN partners, and really looking to make this experience together something additive, and to make the momentum toward a full-scale climate emergency mode a reality. And the stocktake has that kind of potential, but it does require all of us working together in this outcome to be happening from all parts of the globe. Really looking forward to sharing around this toolkit. Get in touch with me by email if you ever need the link, and we'll take it forward together. Thanks.
Perfect. A couple of last two slides, and then I will give the floor to Laura. The upcoming agendas. So we have said that there are a number of meetings scheduled, and we are offered as LGMA seats to speak or interact in this process. The first one was the ministerial Copenhagen, and last month we heard from Alison Gillivand, from Dublin Councillor, and in fact she also shared her insight with us through her blog, which we'll be able to read tomorrow with the LGMA bulletin. So we encourage you to subscribe yourself to this bulletin once again. The upcoming next meeting with the Petersburg Climate Dialogue in Berlin, I will be there. In these topics, in this type of discussions, especially when it is ministerial, we only have one seat, and that's why we are trying to make an appropriate balance. The global stock day, the technical dialogues will happen in Bonn in June. There will be four roundtables. We have already received interest from GCOM and C40 for the finance section, adaptation from the Committee of the Regions, and mitigation from Under 2 Coalition. The integrated approach roundtable is currently vacant, but we could also nominate our colleague Marike, basically because she's also based in Bonn and she's been active in more than this integrated approach, as long as there's no other candidate. This has to be communicated to us by tomorrow so that we can communicate this in time to the UNFCCC. On next week, there will be a spatial outputs workshop. We have two seats, and I already committed to be taking one of them. The second seat is also vacant. And on the same week, next week, on the Thursday and Friday, there is the Loss and Damage Transition Committee first workshop. Here we have three seats, and due to their work and the loss and damage agenda, especially Scottish Government, Mayor's Migration Council, Climate Heritage Network, C40, as well as in relation to the adaptation agenda, Regions for Committee of the Regions, we have already reached out to them. And in the worst case, ICLEI will also have a seat. We have our colleagues who are working in the space, also based in Bonn and the Royal Secretariat. But anyone who wants to join these meetings, please inform us by tomorrow so that we convey the delegation list to the UN. And finally, the upcoming agendas, other than Petersburg Dialogue, in Brussels, we will have Committee of the Regions discussing their position towards COP28. UNDRR midterm review of Sendai will take place in May in New York. The same days, G7 Leaders Summit will convene in Hiroshima. There will be water agenda in Bonn. In Paris, there will be an important couple of days because of the negotiations on the Global Plastics Treaty. Second round is taking place. City of Paris, together with a bunch of networks of local governments, including ICLEI, C40, UCLG, and especially with the guidance from UNEP, there will be a mayor's forum on the Plastics Treaty on Friday, 26th, and the official negotiations, ICLEI and UCLG will represent the local authorities' major group. In June, we will be very, very heavily busy. It will be the second UN Habitat Assembly in Nairobi. We know there will be a high-level climate event on the 6th of June, and there is a mayor's summit, World Mayor's Assembly of the Global Task Force on the 8th of June, And we're expecting a number of side events to take place as well. In June in Bonn, we will have the UN climate talks, especially in the same time. But we are recommending that the majority of the LGMA engagement will be reserved for the second week so that we can link from the outcome from Nairobi. We will convene the entities 11th to 13th of June. And especially on the 12th of June, we would like to have a special dialogue with the UNFCCC leaders, with including champions, in a kind of a closed format so that we can have frank discussions on that. A couple of days later, we will have in Tangier, MetCop, Mayor Sofiane is hosting this. It will be one of the unique moments for the Mediterranean cities. At COP28, there are some more updates. First of all, the World Leaders Summit was the original name, but now it's World Climate Action Summit on the first couple of days. At the 21st or 2nd of June, of course, it should be once, 1st and 2nd of December. For the first time, there will be a mayoral delegation, mayors or subnational delegation. In the past, in the Paris Climate Summit in 2015, we were not in the leaders' summit. Our city hall, Paris City Hall, was the place for all our leaders. In Glasgow, we had on the C40 a chair, Mayor Garcetti, in the leaders' summit. In Sharm el-Sheikh, we had only Tokyo governor speaking there. So it was only one-off event or one individual only. Based on the announcement from Bloomberg and COP28 president, we assume there will be a big agenda for us, and we look forward to their announcements. The middle of the week is not traditional Sunday, but it will be 7th of December, Thursday. And we are expecting that the cities, regions, and urbanization day, and we are very happy that the term urbanization is appearing now, will be in the second week, at the beginning of the second week, not the end, but the second week, beginning of the second week, especially in connection to the finance day, and that the urbanization and climate ministerial will also have a strong discussion with finance ministers, which is very good news for us. And throughout these 2 weeks, LGMA Pavilion will be, as usual, the home for cities and subnationals in between all these meetings, but also an opportunity for us to really have our own space, our own home, so that we can define our key messages and communicate and share our updates so that we participate effectively to the negotiations on the Blue Zone. With this, I give you the floor now to Laura to take us through the updates from the biodiversity processes.
Thank you, Eunice. Can you hear me? Well, good. Yes, greetings from Cape Town, from City's Biodiversity Center. My name is Laura Lowe. I work in biodiversity advocacy with my colleague Ingrid Kutsi, Director of Biodiversity, Nature and Health. And unfortunately, she couldn't make it today, so I'm stepping in on her behalf. The first thing is that as a follow-up to COP15, to really keep the momentum going, after 11 decisions were adopted, really mentioning the role and importance of local and subnational governments. And we had a very successful 7th summit for subnational governments and cities at COP15. We want to keep the momentum going and organize a webinar series. The International Day for Biological Diversity, it's celebrated on the 22nd May. And we are about to launch a webinar series called From Agreement to Action, which is the theme of the International Day for Biological Diversity. And we are organizing 5 webinar sessions, as you can see on the slide, really focusing on what regions and cities are currently doing to reach the 30 by 30 targets and the GBF targets by 2030. We are busy organizing the webinar arrangements at the moment, so the registration will open from 1st May. Next slide, please. Other events that are taking place in biodiversity advocacy field is definitely Rise Africa Action Festival, which is organized and convened around the Africa Day, which takes place on 25 May. So our office is very much involved in organizing the Ramsar Wetlands Across Africa and Benefits for African Cities webinar. And you can, that takes place on Tuesday, 23rd May. And the registration is at the moment open, so you can see the link to the website. So please do and also visit the program. There's lots of very inspiring webinars and actions taking place, and very exciting examples shared from different African cities. That also ties into one of our big partnerships, which is Italy has been working with the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands as the co-chair of the Independent Advisory Committee for Wetland City Accreditation since 2015, and since 2019, we have been the co-chair. So the second roundtable for Wetland City Mayors, at the moment there's 45 Wetland Cities accredited around the world. And this is organized by the Ramsar Regional Center East Asia, and it takes place in Amiens City in France, 8 to 10 June. So at the same time, we are also convening with the Independent Advisory Committee, and that takes place at the same time. And obviously this all leads to the preparations for the 62nd, or you skipped the, oh, thank you, to the 62nd Standing Committee meeting of the parties of the convention, which takes place in September. Next September. The next slide, please. Another important launch was actually yesterday. In partnership with the Convention on Migratory Species, ICLE has produced a curb light pollution in your city guide, which really is a good resource to help cities reduce impact on wildlife. So there's lots of case studies, information resources, and there's checklists for cities to how to start this process of reducing light pollution. So I highly recommend visiting the link. So, and also we are preparing for the, to close our collaboration with the CMS, the next COP14 is taking place in Samarkand, Uzbekistan, end of October. And regarding COP15 and next steps, the next major meeting of the Convention on Biological Diversity will take place in Nairobi, Kenya, end of October. They just confirmed the date. And we are currently preparing comments on the long-term strategic approach to mainstreaming biodiversity within and across sectors. So there's quite a lot of work leading up to these meetings, and it's very exciting work. So thank you so much, Yunus, for this opportunity, and that's everything for me.
Thanks, Laura, and also thanks to Ingrid. She was with us in the morning session. And we also shared this, especially when I heard about the first stocktake taking place in Concord on the 22nd of May. I was immediately recalling that it is, in fact, the Biodiversity Day. So this could be a message to Kale. We have to make sure that in this first stocktake, we could also make a good connection to the bridge between nature and climate agenda. So these are good convergences. And we know, especially in the Dubai COP28, there will be a number of initiatives that will introduce topics like food and nature positive development also into this process, as well as you can see similar things coming from G7 and G20 process. I think with this, we're now end of our inputs. We know it was a bit intense, but we appreciate your any immediate reactions. Anything we missed, anything that we have forgotten, feel free to update us. Or if you have any questions, if you have any additional remarks, feel free to share with us. This is an opportunity for you to interact. This will be also shared through our regular channels and also available on the website. We once again recommend you to refresh or make sure you subscribe to our monthly bulletin, because this is the opportunity where you can find all these updates that we have shared with you, and even those we are not able to discuss with also the links and also publicly available, so that you can share in your own communities. Tomorrow's edition will also promote Concord and a number of other important updates. If not, we can always be more than happy to save a couple of minutes in your agenda so that you can use this buffer for your personal or institutional, let's say, gathering of your other information that you don't have to wait until the end of this webinar to finish. In that sense, if we see there's no need for additional inputs, we can announce the session is closed. We thank you all for your support and participation and engagement. I would like to once again especially recommend all the LGMA members to go back to your own colleagues, especially for the nominations for the Global Stocktake and the Loss and Damage Transitional Committee, which the deadlines are tomorrow. So please inform us so that we can communicate this list to the UN as appropriate, UNFCCC. Thank you very much and have a nice day and have a nice evening wherever you are.